This is a standard end mill. We see it walking around the outside of a part, and it is beautiful. But sometimes when we use this same approach on an inside pocket, we can run into trouble. The chips created by our helical end mills can be longer than our actual flute length. And these long chips can stack up tightly, creating a picket fence of sorts, making it really hard for our chips to escape. If our cut chips are not able to get out of the way in time, our end mill is gonna run them over again and again. This is gonna sound like we're chewing gravel. Remember this sound. That is the sound of our end mill slowly dying, wearing out prematurely. This sound is often followed up by your boss putting down his coffee and running out to the shop floor to see what has gone wrong. Now, one solution is to go with a chip splitter end mill. Now, these chip splitter end mills can reduce our chip length by up to 2/3. Now, we are still able to take deep axial depth of cuts without the unwanted challenges that come with those long chips. Smaller chips, beautiful finishes, all with these chip splitter end mills. And as we listen to this tool cut, we can just tell that it is happier. There is a lot less recutting of chips going on. If we want to create even smaller chips, we have a more extreme option available to us. We can use a dedicated roughing end mill, which will dice our chips into the smallest of pieces. And our coolant will have no problem flushing those chips out of the way. Our roughing end mill has some clear advantages when it comes to creating smaller chip sizes, with the biggest drawback being that our tool is going to leave lines on our parts. And in most cases, we will want to follow up our roughing end mill with a finishing end mill to get rid of those roughing lines. Roughers require less horsepower than a standard end mill for typical cuts and are much better equipped for slotting as well. The tool path for our standard and chip splitter end mills are going to look very similar to each other. A true roughing end mill, however, can handle a higher radial engagement, a bigger step over, which in itself can save time, all other things being equal. When choosing a rougher, we can go with a high-speed cobalt or carbide. They may look the same, but we can quickly tell the difference just by their weight. Carbide tools are much heavier. Now, these 8% cobalt roughers are sharp, tough, and will introduce less stress and cutting forces into our part than a standard end mill. They are a great value for what they can accomplish. Now, the same rougher made out of solid carbide will cost more than its cobalt cousin, but it may be able to run at 10 times the speed, which can help us reduce cycle times. Now, beyond material types, cobalt versus carbide, these roughers are available with fine or rough teeth. In general, the harder material that we're working with, the smaller the teeth, the smaller the serrations we will choose. If we're working with a mild steel or an aluminum, we'll choose a coarse tooth. If we're working with hardened steels or a super alloy, we're probably going to go with a smaller tooth, a smaller serration. Our machine chips tell us the entire story. We have our standard, our chip splitter, and our roughing end mills. And when we took these parts out of the machine, we did not blow them off. We walked them straight from the machine to this table. And we cleaned out the machine completely in between each tool so we didn't get our chips mixed up. Now with the standard end mill, we should end up with long chips, longer than the flutes of our end mill like we showed you in that graphic earlier. Now, this is what they should look like, but what we got was this. If you look at this pile here, you'll see long chips, small chips, little pieces of chips, bent chips. These chips have seen things. They have been around. And the reason they don't look like they should, long single chips, is because they have been through a blender. They have been cut and recut, and that's where that terrible sound came from earlier. Not our best choice for this pocket. And again, we didn't shove these chips in here. These were left over after the operation. This is exactly like how your part would look like if you were running a pocket with a standard end mill. Moving over to a chip splitter end mill, and we look inside this pocket, we did not blow this pocket out. This is what the part looked like when we got small, consistent chips. From this pile right here to this pile, all these chips look identical. Perfectly formed, repeatable, small chips, because that's what this end mill was designed to do, to give us perfect, small, repeatable chips. And again, looking inside of our pocket here that was made with our roughing end mill, there's no chips at all. The chips were washed out of our part like grains of sand by our coolant. And that's what this end mill is designed to do, to give us very small, easy to handle chips. And these test parts are not the only parts that give us this problem. It happens every day. A few months back, I was running this part with these vanes down the center of it, and I got into trouble. My end mill was creating long, tall chips that wouldn't get out of the way for me. And so I fixed the problem by moving to a roughing end mill. Problem solved. The next time you run across a pocket that's giving you that terrible noise, reach for a chip splitting end mill. An end mill that can work as both rougher and finisher. Or reach for a roughing end mill. You might have to follow it up with a finishing end mill, but you won't have any chip problems whatsoever. Well, that's it. Thanks for watching this Haas Tip of the Day.